Hey, what's going on, people? This is another edition of the Ace Takers Rant, saying just gonna go over week 12 thoughts of my teams, my three main teams, the Detroit Lions, Houston Texans, and Oakland Raiders, who actually finally broke their year-long losing streak. Going 1-10 on Thursday. They hadn't won a game since the same week last year in 2013, and they finally won it. So, what I'm gonna do, because most of my rants is focused on the Detroit Lions, but what I'm gonna do is I'm going to talk about the Oakland Raiders first, because that was a good thing that happened. The other two, the Detroit Lions and Houston Texans losing, are the two things that obviously didn't make today a good day for any fans of those two teams. Going through this shit for a second week with the fucking Lions. Not good. But let me talk about the Oakland Raiders really quickly. I'm not going to spend too much time on talking about the Oakland Raiders. But thank God they won their game. Man, as a Raider fan, you know, living on the eastern part of the country, you know, I don't live on the western part of the country with the rest of the Raider fans, but it was so hard just to think about the Raiders and all the stuff that they went through. It was so hard, man. It took me back to the 0-16 season with the Detroit Lions. You guys who, there's not too many teams in this league that have been in that snake-bitten mode or have been in that mode where they've gone through really long losing streaks like that. Like, they might have had some losing seasons, but you didn't really see them lose, like, maybe 10 games in a row, 16 in a row, or whatever. You know, and you guys have to understand what it feels like to lose that many games in a row. I would like for everybody's fan base to experience that at least once in their lifetime, what it means to, because it'll make you appreciate the wins even more. That's why I say teams like the Oakland Raiders, the Detroit Lions, the Cleveland Browns, and to an even a further extent, the Houston teams, like, because the Oilers and Texans, they've been a snake man franchise. They've gone to the championship games and couldn't get to the Super Bowl. So those fan bases have gone through a lot of shit. And, you know, like I said, very long losing streaks. It just feels good when you finally fucking win, man. And I was so happy for the Raiders on Thursday, man. I can say that the Stafford moments, those four quarter comebacks were pretty damn good. But probably within the last two seasons, or maybe even three, that was the best moment I've saw in football in the last 3 years. Just that team being able to beat their rivals, the Kansas City Chiefs rivals, on their home field in the rain, having the fans who supported them in Oakland. And I'll probably touch upon that while I'm talking about the Raiders. I want to talk about that whole little home situation that they're facing with that whole LA and San Antonio rumors. Like I said, it was just a great moment. It was a great moment because Derek Carr finally got his first win. I thought it was long overdue. This kid's played very well all season. It seems like if he was on a different team, he probably would have won like four or five games by now. But on this team, he's just getting his first win. And he's the real deal. Like I told you guys last week, they finally got it right with Mack and Carr. Whether you are a believer today of Derek Carr or not, you got to like this kid, man. I mean, he is a very non-selfish player. He's already showing great leadership skills. You talk to a lot of the Oakland Raider players, this dude is constantly on the sidelines, pumping dudes up, putting them in a positive mind frame. That's the guy that you want. Those are some of the things that Tim Tebow was bringing. That's how a lot of people like Tim Tebow, man. He had the little faith thing on his side, but the thing about it was with Tim Tebow, he just couldn't play, man. But it's unfortunate that he didn't know how to play, because I thought that he would have been a good leader for whatever team he was on. But hopefully Derek Carr is that guy. I mean, he did a great job of carrying him in that fourth quarter drive. I was amazed with him. I was just so happy with the other Raider fans, especially the Raider fans in Oakland, man, who have had to go on through the last 10 years of this bullshit, man. Like I said, I think the sun is finally rising on this franchise. I think that they're going the right way. There's still some little things that's going to not make everything too good in their growth. You know, they got the stadium situation, which I think is the main thing that's actually hampered this team the last 10 years. I've been telling people that. I don't think it's the team. I think it's the stadium situation. Because the Raiders have been in relocation rumors, shit, probably since the 70s, man, when you think about it. Because when they moved to L.A. in the early 80s, you know, there was rumors then. And then the rumors started back in the late 80s going into the early 90s. And they finally did the move back up to Oakland. You could even throw a move. I heard some rumors. Like, I read some old magazine articles that they're thinking about moving to Mexico and shit like that, man. Like, it was really that wild with the Raiders, man. And it kind of started back, even though they found their home back in Oakland for a long time. And then when they started losing again, Al was getting on the wrong side of 80. You know, it really started back up, and Mark Davis is taking over, and now they're really in there because, you know, these could be the last two games that they play in Oakland. Unless they do another one-year lease. Mark Davis says he doesn't really want to do another one-year lease because he thinks that gets everybody in a comfortable position where they don't want to be proactive about getting a stadium done. Look, Mark Davis, don't get mad at Mark Davis, man. He wants his team to stay in Oakland, man. He wants to keep this team in Oakland. Neither side is budging, though, on a new stadium, though, man. You know, and hey, I blame it more on Oakland politics, man. You guys should, you know, I don't know. Maybe Mark Davis is going to have to partner up with another company to get a private thing going on to get the stadium built, man. Because I don't know if the Oakland City Council is ever going to let them get the stadium built. And it's unfortunately because I think that the Raiders belong in Oakland, you know. L.A. is a pretty good place for them. They're able to get a new stadium in Los Angeles. I think that's another good city. Though the thing that I don't want to ever fucking see is the Raiders moving out of California. It does not fucking mix that they move out of California. Never have them move out of California. San Antonio, get the fuck out of here. What the fuck is the San Antonio Raiders? That shit don't even sound right. The Raiders' culture and history is in California, and it should remain put in California. I'm not saying, like I said, San Antonio, we know with the Spurs, they're a pretty good sports town, man. I don't really think it's necessary for them to have three fucking Texas teams in the fucking state. I think you're good with just the Cowboys and Texans, man. But if San Antonio wants another team, let them get it some other way. Because I remember the New Orleans thing was a rumor too. If they ever did move to San Antonio, it'd be just like that Oklahoma City move with the Seattle Supersonics moving from. And that shit still has not been going over easy with a lot of fans. And I'm talking about non-Seattle fans. That move still hasn't looked right at all. But, you know, we'll see what happens in the offseason. You know, the NFL is desperate to get a team playing there as early as next season. The stadium probably won't be ready until, like, 2017 or 2018. But the NFL is desperate to get a team up there as early as next season. The other two teams that we keep hearing about is the St. Louis Rams and San Diego Chargers. St. Louis Rams has a very likely chance. And the thing about St. Louis is just like an Oakland situation. They have the lease thing, I think, at the end of the year. They don't have to be in the dome after this year in St. Louis. So they could move on after Stan Kroenke has, I think he bought some land or some shit out in L.A. So the L.A. Rams, who used to play there before 1995, you know, they could be returning back as well. The Chargers is an iffy situation because I know they're trying to get a stadium built, but that hasn't worked either. So all three of these teams are definitely candidates. And I definitely see one of these teams moving to L.A. next year. I don't see them sticking it out for another season where they are. And I'm just saying one of the three. You know, it's going to be unluckily one of the three gets moved. But we will see, and maybe an L.A. move is a temporary move. Maybe, hopefully, for one of these teams. Because the thing about it is, between St. Louis and Oakland, they've lost their teams already. So this will be the second time in the city's history where they've lost a team. And you wonder if they can get a team back within the next 10 years. Look how long it's taken L.A. It's taken them 20 years to get a team back. So, and I know there's a lot of good, there's a lot of good football fans in Missouri, St. Louis, man, that area right there. I would hate for them. I hate to see anybody lose a fan. That's why I'm more in favor of expansion. But the thing about expansion is it splits the money up even more between owners, and that's why you don't see expansion too much happen nowadays. Like the last time you really saw expansion happen was like back in the 90s with a lot of these leagues. You don't see it anymore because of the TV pie. It's changed all that. These owners have gotten even more greedier. You know, it's a whole mess. But that's the situation, man, with Oakland, man. I'm hoping that team stays in Oakland for another season. Hopefully they can work things out with that stadium thing. I know they have Levi's Stadium in San Francisco as an option to go to. But I don't think they'll do that unless they definitely know they've got another stadium getting built. I've said it. It'd be nice if Oakland could maybe get a dome this time around, a retractable roof or something, so they can hold Super Bowls and bring a lot more money into the city of Oakland. You know, and I think that's what that city needs, man. They need some money pumped into that city, man. They've had the sports teams all this time, man, and they really haven't taken advantage of it like I think they should have. But I don't want to get into that whole time because a lot of you waiting on Lions talk or not. I'm like, what is this guy talking about for 10 minutes? But so I'm going to move into my Lions, man. Another tough Sunday for the Lions. You know, it's tough to take these losses, man. I take my losses pretty hard with the Lions. This one was a little bit easier than last week, and I'll tell you why. Because it was already over by halftime. So usually, you know, if it's close, it's very hard. I've had a few hours to sort of dwell on it and just think about what's ahead. And that's what I'm going to be doing when I'm talking about the Lions. So I'm not going to review this game or talk about it. I'm probably just going to make references to it. But this is a team right now that's 7-4. They started out 7-2 before they faced these two. Man, it's just hard for me to call Arizona an elite team, but I mean their record is elite. It's 9-2 right now. They did lose. I want to address something. There was a guy on here last week in my comment section, and I appreciate you guys watching my video last week. That was my first really hit video that I've had. I've never had a video on this particular channel that pertained to sports that actually got more than 200 views. So I was very happy about that. Hopefully you guys will return this week. And like I said, I appreciate you all. Even the guy who I forgot his name, man, but he was in the comments and he was upping his Cardinals. I think the Cardinals was his team. If his team is the Cardinals, then he can correct me, man. If you're listening to this dude, you can correct me if you want. But the Cardinals are your team, man. I'm kind of glad I waited till nighttime to make this rant instead of doing it in the afternoon, because they've already lost the Arizona Cardinals and the Seahawks brought them back down to earth. And I tried to tell Cardinal fans, because it wasn't just him, but it was other Cardinal fans on different sports sites that I was get hit up on by, and I was telling them that the Cardinals are just a hot team. They're not really that good. They're 5-5, maybe a 6-4, 7-3 type team disguised as a 9-1 team. And they finally lost to Seattle today, and I knew they were probably going to lose to Seattle today. Seattle was just thirsty. They knew they needed to win. This was part of their season to keep up in the division, and don't look back, but both Seattle and San Francisco are only two games behind the Cardinals. There's a chance that, you know, I know Seattle and San Francisco will be head-to-head for another big game Thanksgiving night and this Thursday. But don't look now, man. You guys only got a two-game lead. You know, you guys had a really good, comfortable record, usually 9 wins. In a lot of cases, if the teams behind you aren't that good or got more than 6 wins, you're pretty feeling comfortable. But now, Drew Stanton is your quarterback. You lost. You went back down to earth this week, so your hot streak is over with. You cooled off. I don't know how long Fitzgerald is going to be out, but right now, Arizona Cardinals. Yeah, I think your team is going to make the playoffs, but I told you guys, man. Hold your horses, man. Hold your horses, because I told you guys were just hot, man. You guys were lucky to come out of the game last week against the Lions. You guys were lucky that my team was in a rut, you know, offensively. So, just watch your back. Watch your back, because Seattle, San Francisco, they're coming. They're coming. They're coming for that division, too. And they've done it before. They'll do it again this year. Now, I don't think it'll be both of them, but one of those two. I think the winner of this next game is going to be the one that chases you guys down and takes the division away from you. So, we'll see. But back to my Lions. Ugly loss to New England today. And the thing is, you know, with the Patriots, man, they're such a good team, man. And to me, they're the best team in the league. And nothing deviated me when they were 2-2 starting off the year. I've always believed that they could get the things turned around. And when they lost against Kansas City, I said, people are making a bigger deal of this than they are. I said, Tom Brady's going to figure this thing out later on in the season. Once he gets a couple of pieces healthy, gets a couple of weapons back, they're going to be rolling. And Bill Belichick took that loss against Kansas City personally. It seems like he's on a mission right now. Every team he's facing, he's knocking them the fuck out, man. He is. This guy's beat 4 division winners, and I'm telling you, he's going to get. I can't wait until he gets the Green Bay fuckers in Lambo next week. I cannot wait. I've been waiting on that game all year for the Packers to get beat on their own field, man. And he's going to do it, man. He's going to beat the fucking Green Bay fuckers on their field, man. I cannot wait for this fucking game next week with the Patriots, man. They're going to fucking whoop ass. They're going to go out there and whoop ass on them, man. And it's going to make us Lions fans feel a lot better, because the Packers have really, since the bye week, have been upping us. They've had the upper hand on us. So, it's going to be very interesting to see how that game goes. But New England is in Super Bowl mode right now. They're not taking any prisoners. They want to get back there. Their last 2 visits to the Super Bowl didn't go their way. They won't have to worry about facing the Giants again this year. They're ready. They are clearly ready for another Super Bowl run. And for the Lions, maybe this is the one team you shouldn't be embarrassed to lose to, because not many teams have stopped this team, man. Pretty much nobody, man. Like I said, I don't expect the Packers to beat them next week. They're at home. The Packers looked very, very human this week against Minnesota. Like I said, those two wins, I don't know why some people put too much stock into those. Clearly, the Bears didn't even fucking play them. I mean, they weren't even fucking playing in that fucking game. The Eagles didn't look like they were playing them either. And then they come out and beat the Titans and get their shit together this week. So, to me, this is the one team in the league, the Patriots, who are legit. The one team that you could count on every week to get the job done. And so this week is no different. I did expect it to be closer. I said there's a chance that the Lions can win, but this is before I really knew that the offense was a problem. And I'm going to go into that. You know, what I'm going to do here in this Lions talk, man, I'm going to talk about the next few games. I'm going to talk about the outlook of the Lions. But what I want to talk about right now is the offensive problems. Look, the problems that the Lions are having on offense right now are catastrophic, because the defense has been really good this year. And even though the Patriots put up tagless for like 24 points before, you know, they settled down a little bit and ended up only getting up to 34, because they could have easily got up to 50 if they wanted to in this game. If our defense was not that good, they would have got up to 50 points in this game. But, like I said, the defense for the Lions right now, they're keeping them in ball games. But I can see that the offensive struggles are starting to affect the defense a little bit. And this is what I was worried about in the beginning, because I said that how long is our defense going to hold on and be one-sided like this, you know? And I think the offense is putting too much pressure on the defense. Clearly saw that the last 2 weeks, not a sack, I believe, recorded. So, to me, the problem on this team isn't the defense. I still feel very confident about this defense going the rest of the way. That's not even a mere problem, but we do need to fix shit on offense. Stafford clearly having his worst year as a full-year starter. And I think that there's a huge reason why that he's tailed back a little bit. He's lost his confidence. It's as simple as that. One of the things that you don't hear from the TV analysts really point out is quarterbacks losing their confidence. It happens all the time in the NFL. Eli Manning is going through it right now in New York. There's a number of different quarterbacks in the league who were elite in past years and have ducked off this year. Robert Griffin III, I think he's another guy that's lost his confidence. There's a lot of dudes, a lot of quarterbacks in this league that lose confidence. It doesn't excuse them from losing games, but you got to think about it. I mean, Matthew Stafford is a gunslinger at heart, man. He's a gunslinger quarterback, and this coaching staff with Caldwell and Lombardi have tried to trim him down and dial him back to being a game manager. And there's nothing wrong with that because game managers can win Super Bowls. We've seen it all the time happen. And you want your quarterback to be more of a game manager than a gunslinger. But the problem is you don't want to do it to a point where it takes the quarterback out of their comfort zone. Because now what I'm seeing is with Stafford, guys, it really started the downspin with Stafford to me started, you know, maybe about 2 years ago when a receiver started really dropping the balls. It happened even more last year. Even Calvin Johnson, a guy that he depends on, drops the ball. Horrible blocking this season. This is one of the top blocking units last season. Stafford barely got touched. I think it was only like over 10 times last year. They were leading the league in least sacks allowed. And, man, I don't even know what the stat is this year, but, man, that's it'd be ugly whenever I look at it. You know, he's lost confidence, man. He's lost confidence because I think when they dialed him back, man, I think he's scared to throw the way he wants to now, man. Stafford before under Scott Linehan used to just sling the bitch. I mean, the thing was he did need to cut back on the turnovers. That was doing us in a number of games. I do understand that. But when you look at the quarterback, the other gunslingers that have worked, like a Brett Favre or something like that, you know, these guys have been able to win at the same time being a gunslinger. They turn the ball over. They're turnover machines, but they're able to produce points. And that's the thing that we're missing this year, because there's a number of games we probably will be at about 9 wins by now if we had a couple of games this year where we could have scored points in our losses. Carolina, Arizona, those two games come to mind. I still don't think we would have beat the Patriots even scoring, but it would have looked a lot better, okay? It would have been a lot more competitive. But they've got to, and this is a short week. This is the only thing I hate about them playing on Thursday. It's a really short week. They're not able to make drastic changes, but to me, Lombardi and Caldwell, maybe Caldwell's got to make the decision. He's got to get Stafford back to where he was before, man. Being more confident, throwing the ball down the field, being a gunslinger. Because that way, he was at least putting points up on the board. Maybe he wasn't effective, you know, as far as playing winning football. But if you think about it, if you can find a balance between that gunslinger style and the way that they've coached him up. Because one of the things I still like about what Stafford done this year than the past years, he would throw it away. He won't just force it. He would throw the football away. That's something that you see like a Super Bowl quarterback like Russell Wilson doing. You'll even see Tom Brady doing it. When it's not there, just throw it out. But on some of these throws, man, he just hasn't been able to make them. And like I said, it's a collective unit because guys have dropped balls, especially in this game. Stafford was right on the money in some of his throws And they just weren't there. And he was steadily losing confidence throughout the game, man. And it's unfortunate, man. To me, the only receiver he can rely on right now is Golden Tate. He can't even rely on Megatron right now, man. Calvin Johnson, man. He can't really... Calvin Johnson's been a shadow of himself, man. And, you know, he needs the support of a running game, man. He has no running game right now. I would say that the Lions need to really go get somebody off the street right now and play that running back position. I love Jorge Bell, man, but he's a complimentary running back. He should be a second running back. He shouldn't be the feature guy. They need to find someone. Look at what the Broncos did today with C.J. Anderson, or last week with the great kid on New England, man. They need to find somebody off the street. We could have got LeGarrette Blount, man. That's the frustrating thing about it. We could have got LeGarrette Blount. Get a guy who knows how to run the football, because we need someone who knows how to run it a little bit better. But I will say this in defense of the running backs this year, the blocking has been absolutely horrible. This is the thing that's going to keep the Lions back from doing what they want to do, too. It's the blocking, man. The blocking is the worst unit on this team. It used to be the secondary for the last few years. That has finally shorn itself up thanks to the defensive coordinator, Terrell Austin, putting his guys in the right spots in that secondary. But the problem now is this fucking offensive line. We're having huge depth problems there. We're not finding anybody who could really block. It's horrible, man. It's horrible. And we haven't been able to have a good balance between pass and run this year because of it, man. We just don't have a good running game right now. So I'm not sure what they could do, but I like I said, hopefully they can pick up someone off the street. Reggie Bush has turned into a China doll. We just cannot trust that guy anymore. A lot of problems, man. Just a lot of problems on his team right now offensively, and hopefully they can get it corrected. I forgot who it was. I was watching Fox post-game show, and I think it was Troy Aikman. And this is why I like listening to Troy Aikman. I hate Joe Buck, but Troy Aikman is an analyst I love listening to, man. He'll be brutally honest in his analysis, man. You know, he's very, I think a lot of time, I don't know, maybe it's because he works in the 18, doesn't get as much respect as he should as an analyst. But he brought up the fact that, I think at the end of the game, that it's a confidence thing. And if Matthew Stafford, maybe if he would have made one of those, if he would have been able to complete one of those throws, the Corey Fuller play, the four-year play in the end zone, man, could the game have been different had he just been able to complete those throws? Now, looking ahead to Thanksgiving, if Matthew Stafford could put it together, he could gain some confidence back, you know? He gained some confidence back, man. I mean, it's not impossible. Like I said, I think that's the biggest thing for Matthew Stafford, man. I think he just needs to get his confidence back. This is the Bears team coming in here with pretty good momentum, winning two games in a row. They're trying to get back in the playoff picture. That's what makes this a dangerous game on Thursday. But at the end of the day, unlike these last two games, the Lions are still the better team. Lions are the better team all the way up until the point that they play Green Bay. They're going to be the better team in their next four games. Let's look ahead. Okay, like I said, they got the Bears on Thursday. This is a nervous game for Lion fans because they know they can't lose this game. The Lions really need to win at least three of the next four, I think, in order to make the playoffs. At least puts them at 10-6, but we've seen what happened with the Cardinals last year. With 10-6 might not get you in. It really depends on how the other teams in the wild card are doing. 11-5 definitely gets you in, though. Wild card or not, 11-5 gets you in. 11-5 might win the division. Green Bay needs to lose at least two of the next five games. If the Patriots could do what they need to do, that puts Detroit right back in the driver's seat in the division race. And the Lions win, of course. like I said, this thing could be totally flipped around on one game this week. You know, Lions could go back to feeling confident about themselves in winning these next few games. Look, a lot of people want to throw out that second half collapse out there. I talked about this last week. People are waiting for the Lions to have that second half collapse. They're feeling really good about it after this week. I think that this is a different team. I don't think that's going to happen to them this year. Even after these two losses, I just don't see it. I think if the Lions win their game this week, I'm pretty much confident that they will beat Minnesota. They'll beat Tampa Bay at home. Both teams playing a little bit better than they did. Well, Minnesota, you just don't know what team is going to show up. Like they showed up really good this week. They showed up really good in the first half of the game against the Bears last week, but then lost in the second half. You don't know what you're going to get there. And then they got a pretty good defense. So that's another game that's not a huge guarantee. We know the Vikings are going to come in there and play hard. They already lost to us early in the year. They wanted to spoil us. You know, I'm expecting that to be a pretty close game. Unless Stafford changes his shit around and he starts playing hot doing a whole fucking game, then we'll be able to win that game pretty easily. And that's the same thing with Tampa Bay. But then going into Soldier Field in Chicago, you know, things start to get a little bit on the iffy side, because if the Bears are still playing good football around that time, that's a game that could go either way, just like last year's game at Soldier Field, you know. And then you got Green Bay. You know, that game is either going to be for the division or for a playoff spot for the Lions. Wild card spot or something. I do think that game is going to matter at the end of the year. Got to take care of business. What the Lions need to do, they need to put everything square at zero, hit that fucking reset button, hit that reset button on that playbook on the offensive side, throw that shit away. Whatever they're doing is not working offensively. Start over this week. New game plan. Tell themselves, hey, the new season starts today. The new season starts on Thursday, all right? 7-4. We can get our asses to 11-4. We can use the next four games as preseason games, okay? Until that Packers game. Use these four games as exhibition games, man. Preseason games. Get yourself ready for that Packers game. Because that's the one game that's going to matter as long as we win these next four. Okay? We got to be able to sweep the Bears. That's going to be the hardest task that I see coming up. It's just being able to sweep the Bears, man. Because there's a possibility the Bears could get one of these games. We swept them last year. And can we do it again? You know? I do feel very confident that the Lions get this thing back together. Because one thing I know for sure, the Lions have never feared Jay Cutler. They never feared this dude. Sue always takes this guy's head off. If you look at the game last year in Detroit where Detroit beats the shit out of Chicago, they could do it again, man. They could bring this Bears team who haven't even looked that good. Even though they've won in their last game, have not looked that good. I thought they were going to lose to Tampa. Like, they've been having these second half surges, but the Lions could put that team out early, get it going. Minnesota. Another team, like I said, I've already gone over that. Then Tampa Bay. If you've already won those two games in Tampa Bay, you should be looking at that like, man, we got three, and now all of a sudden we're 10-4. So we're where we need to be to even make the playoffs. Okay, we got the 10 wins that we need. Lions get the 10 wins. Okay. If you trip up in any three of these home games, you have to win that game at Soldier Field. That's when that game really fucking matters at Soldier Field. If you trip up on any of these three, if you lose to the Bears on Thursday, but rebound against the Vikings and Tampa Bay Buccaneers, rebound on those two, and then get your revenge back against the Bears at Soldier Field. Okay, it needs to be 3 out of 4. I don't care what way it is in the 3 out of 4, but it needs to be 3 out of 4, and even better, all four. Then you get yourself to 11. Then you're starting to talk about, hey, if Green Bay loses one or two of their next few games, all of a sudden that game at the end of the year might not even matter, you know, because then the Lions could be in a position where they're trying to win 12. Will Green Bay even reach 12, you know? Let's do something, because I did this last week with the Texans. I'm about to talk about the Texans, because this thing is about to get to 40 minutes. I don't really like going too long. My videos, so I don't like hitting the hour mark. But let's talk about the Green Bay Packers. schedule real quick. Okay. Patriots next week, I'll talk about that one. Monday night game is Falcons. They're going to win that one. I don't even know. That's a Monday night game? Oh, my God. The god-awful Falcons? Oh, my God. So, I guess that's a win for Green Bay. At the Bills, that's probably a win, too. Damn, they got basically almost the same easy-ass schedule as we got. They got at the Bills and at Tampa Bay. They're going to be Tampa Bay and Tampa Bay. And then the Lions, last game of the season. Now we probably do need the Patriots to beat them because I do see them beating the Falcons, Bills, and Buccaneers. The Bills game can be a challenge. Depending on how the Bills look tomorrow, man, they're still in the playoff race. We'll see how that Bills team looks. That's a possible loss. That's a possible loss, but I just don't know, man. I just don't know too much about Buffalo's confidence in winning that game. But that Patriots game, if Green Bay wins that Patriots game, I don't even know if we'll be able to win the division, man, because they're going to sweep. They got a chance to sweep those next three games. Man, the schedule really played out in their favor down the stretch. But we have an easy schedule, too. Or it looks like that on paper. But like I said, man, you know, I'm closing this up with the Lions, man. You know, as a Lions fan today, I'm depressed about the loss, but I'm looking towards the future. I do think things can get very bright. Like I said, the key thing right now is for this team to, they have to get the confidence back. Get the confidence back. Matthew Stafford has to start slinging the ball again. He's got to get back to scoring. If the Lions can get back to their scoring ways, this team will be hard to beat. Because I'm telling you right now, man, I've said this about this Lions team about 2 or 3 years ago when they first made the playoffs into the 2012 season. That was a disappointment. The defense did not play well that year. If the defense is playing as well as the offense was, with all of this talent on this team, if these two sides, because we've yet to see it for a full 60 minutes of football except in that Giants game this year, if both sides are able to play like that, like the way they did against the Giants in week one, this is a scary team to beat. This is a team that could actually make a run at the Super Bowl. But the confidence has to come within themselves. They got to stop beating themselves, man. They keep doing that. It's annoying because you know the Lions are better than that. They keep beating themselves, man. Get this shit together. Get this balance together. Thursday starts a new season. I don't want to see no offensive struggles on Thursday. I don't want to see any deflated defense patterns. I don't want to see no horrible-ass block. I don't want to see no horrible-ass special teams. I just want to see 60 minutes of balanced football from a team that looks like they're ready for the fucking playoffs. Because if the Giants, if the Lions do make the playoffs this year, I know nobody has confidence in them because they don't beat elite teams on the road or at home. Playoffs in January, everyone starts 0-0. Everyone starts at 0. If the Lions have huge momentum coming into the playoffs, they can beat anybody. Okay? They can use these two losses as learning. As learning tools. They can use these as learning tools because when you lose the two elite teams back-to-back like that on the road, Arizona and New England, it can only make you better. It can only make you better. One of the things that I like seeing today, and I saw this again on the Fox postgame show, Sue and I think somebody else, Rayola, they got some fights at the end of the game, and then off the field, we saw some barking between each other. I like seeing that. It meant that the Lions didn't like to lose. Because I didn't see that shit last year. That's why I don't see a second half meltdown like we saw last year. Because these guys, I think they want to fucking win. I think they want to win, and they'll do it. Starting this Thursday. I'll hear from you guys on Thursday. I'm going to celebrate Thanksgiving, so I'll probably do a video on Thursday. But let me talk about my Houston Texans before closing out. Very disappointed in the Houston Texans. Very disappointed. Had a very impressive win against Cleveland. And then Cleveland has a pretty good impressive road win this week in Atlanta. So it's just... The NFL is so fucking weird, dude. You think you got it figured it out. You think you got it figured out, then you really don't. Like I said, the only constant is the fucking Patriots at this point, man. Everything else is just such a guessing game with this league. Like I said, with the Houston Texans, man, if you're a Houston fan listening to this, you know, I still think Ryan Mallett's the guy. You know, I know he lost to Andy Dalton, but Andy Dalton has impressed me these last 2 weeks. I really didn't think he'd actually go on a roll and win both fucking games, especially after the way they looked against Cleveland the last game. When Andy Dalton plays like this, but that's the problem with Andy Dalton. When it's 12 o'clock on a Sunday, he can play like this. But when it's 7:30, 8:30 on a fucking Sunday night, on a Monday night, he just fucking chokes, man. And he's got to put that together because his team is good enough to make a Super Bowl, to probably be the team to face the Patriots in the AFC Championship game this year. If they really put it together, but I don't know, you know, and I don't know, but Houston, this is a pretty bad day because the Colts won as well. They didn't look that good though in the beginning of that game, the Colts. I thought this game Houston could win. Now they got the 6 losses, and now your margin for error is definitely low at this point. Now you need to fucking win out. And the schedule's easy enough to do that, but you still got to go to Indianapolis. I don't know if this team does it. There's a lot of pressure now, man, because this was not a good loss. And, man, it's just having that loss on top of the fucking Lions losses. You know, I wanted to feel good about myself because the fucking Raiders won on Thursday. I thought that was going to be a nice start to the weekend, and all of a sudden, wow. But look, Houston should be able to win. Tennessee. I like the way they play on offense, man. But they're just not that good to win. They played pretty well the last couple of weeks on offense. But they're not going to beat Texas next week. At least the Texans will be able to win that game. They'll be able to beat the Jaguars. They got the Jaguars twice on their schedule. Really, the Colts and Ravens are the only two games where you really have to think. And they got that Ravens game at home. So, the Colts is probably the only one. The one on the road against the Colts. But Texans being at 5-6 right now, they can't even lose that game. So, I'm not sure where this team is headed. I don't know if they'll eke out a spot in the playoffs or not. But I hope so. This is not a good loss today, though, man. They need to win this game. But we'll see what happens. Hopefully we get Aaron Foster back one of these weeks because we could definitely use him catching the ball out of the backfield, making the game a little bit more easier for Mallett. It was good to have Jadeveon Clowney's lazy ass back out there. no doubt about it. J.J. Watt, you know, that guy just gets it. I'm hoping for better results. Next week should be a game that we take care of business. Got the Titans and Jaguars. Just the same thing for the Texans. Treat these next two games like the preseason. Beat up on the Titans and Jaguars, man. And we'll see where they stand because they could be 7-6 going into that Colts game. And we'll see how the wild card picture looks 2 weeks from now. So we'll see then. But that's going to do it for now, guys. I want to thank you guys for listening. And I will be doing another video after that Lions game on Thursday. So be on the lookout, and we'll see what the Lions do from there. Like I said, this is a big game for the Lions. You know, I think that this is a bigger game for confidence because, like I said before, you know, this team, Matthew Stafford, definitely lacking the confidence right now. He's definitely lacking it right now. He doesn't have any confidence in himself and in his team. And we got to put that back together. So we'll see what happens, man. It's going to be another tough week because all the people that want to see the Lions lose and struggle, the people that I like to brag against, they're going to be all over me. They already were earlier, but, you know, the good thing is it's a short week. You can kind of forget about this game really quickly and handle business against the Bears, man. I know the Bears are trying to make it in as well. It'll be a lot fun if the Bears are just facing us at the wrong time, man. And I can't have the Bears coming in at Ford Field beating us, man. But hopefully two things go my way this week. Lions win. Houston wins. I'm going to talk more about that Raiders-Rams game next week. See if they can get their second win. Rams playing some pretty good football lately. Even though they didn't win today, but they're playing good, pretty good football. And the Patriots game, Patriots and Green Bay fuckers game. So yeah, so we'll see how they do that, man. I want to thank you guys for listening. Peace.